Hello and welcome to the Ethiopian Digest program called Ethiopian Digest in Conversation With. In our conversation, we bring people who have experience of Ethiopia, those who love Ethiopia, those connected to Ethiopia and want to work closely with Ethiopians and for Ethiopia, those who have exciting stories to share with us, those who inspire us. Your host is Bekele Oyecha. Our guest today is Lemin Sisay. Good to have you with us, Lemin. Do you want to say a few words to those who may not know you?
Bekele, thank you so much. I have spent a lot of my life searching for my family, my mother and father and sisters and brothers, all Ethiopians all over the world. And I'm also Chancellor at the University of Manchester. I'm a poet and I'm a writer, and I'm part of the artistic fabric of the Ethiopian diaspora.
Lemin, you have a very unique name. As an Ethiopian myself, you know, I know nobody else holding that name. Do you know why you were called why?
I have an idea of why I was called Y, yes. But I can't tell anybody because I think it's my right to hold that in sort of mind.
That's fine, Lemin. You know, you are a poet, you are a writer, you are mostly, you know, dedicated to writing. You know, I very often read your poems on social media. I used to read them almost every morning. If I'm not exaggerating, of course, you know. You are also a broadcaster. Why do you write? Why should you write?
Well, I've always written. You know, I've written since I was 11, 12 years of age. I've written poetry, and I've always found it to be my own personal way of telling my story and also sort of investigating the kind of the imagination and its limitlessness. So, you know, I can't make a table, you know, I can't build a house, but I can write a poem about making a table and about building a house. And it just happens that that's what I do, and that's all I can do, you know. I have as much respect for a builder as I do for a poet. You see? I have as much respect for an engineer as I have for a philosopher.
Where did it come? Where was the origin? You know, did somebody in your family write?
You know, I really don't know where it came from. I just know that it's what I do. It's what I've always done. You know, you could say to a great artist like Ida Mulane, okay, the photographer, the Ethiopian photographer, and a very good friend of mine, you could say, when did you start to take photographs? And she might say, when she got her first camera. But if you were to ask, when did you start to look at things in a unique way, it'd be very difficult for her to find that exact point, you know. And I think the same with myself as a poet. I can't find the exact place where I decided I was going to be a poet. It just has always been in me, you know, from when I was very young. And some children turn out to be engineers, some turn out to be doctors, some turn out to be agriculture workers. We need all of them. But we need the poets as well, you know. And in Ethiopia, for example, in the monasteries, you know, there is a great tradition of learning classical poetry that goes way back. And so we need poets just like we need engineers, you know, and I could not. Yeah, I don't know how it happened, but it has happened. I'm pleased. I mean, most people will maybe sing and they'll be a doctor. They'll write, but they'll be a lawyer. You know, you can have the two things happening at the same time. But for me, it just happens that I am a writer, yeah.
Thanks, Lemon. Yeah, yes. You are a writer. I enjoy actually reading your writings because they kind of inspire me, but I'm not the only one. There are many who actually get inspired on a daily basis.
You know, the best story I heard once, my friend went to Lalibela and she was being shown around the churches in Lalibela by a young person. And the young person said to her, young Ethiopian, who was like a tour guide, and he said, I know about this man in England, this poet, you know, and my friend said, I know him. And it just made me very proud and very honored that deep into the heart of Ethiopia, somebody had heard of me, you know. Yeah, sorry.
No, that's really interesting because, you know, there are many people that know you, but you may not know about them because people talk about this thing. It might be surprising because, you know, there was an email exchange. I'm in a number of groups and there was an email exchange of about... We are about, I think, 30 of us, you know, people from around the world, thinking about how we can actually do something for Ethiopia. And all of a sudden, somebody sent an email, and it was actually a video of one of your poems. And I said, wow. And he was just saying, he's American, actually. I think he's African-American.
Yeah.
And he was introducing you to the group. And I said, I know him. I know him, but I loved it. So, you know, people really share all those things because, you know, there's somebody they relate to. So there will be somebody. And I'm really keen, you know, for this interview to go as wide as possible because there are lots of Ethiopians I believe should know you and I believe should learn and actually see, you know, get inspired for that matter because that's what's important for me.
Thank you, because I'm inspired constantly by Ethiopia and by Ethiopians. And there are so many incredible people in Ethiopia. My only wish now is that I travel more outside of Addis and go to all four corners of Ethiopia. That's my next thing to do.
Thank you, Lemon. I will come back to that because I have got a question for that, to be honest. You know, despite the challenging days in your early days in life, you know, you have made it. You are now a public figure. What's your philosophy of life now?
Well, my philosophy of life is that I am not defined by my scars, but by the incredible ability to heal. My philosophy for life is that, you know, you have to give back, you have to give back to other people what you've been given. You have to, and I that's my philosophy for life, really, is, you know, you receive more when you give more.
That's very true. The more you give, the more you receive. You know, we receive in abundance.
Yeah.
And yes, every one of us are equally generous. That's what they say.
Yes. Yes.
So I'm taking you to your wonderful book, Lemon. You know, my name is Y. It's extraordinary. It's got a lot in it, and I loved it. And I remember joining you, you know, in August 2019 for the launch in London. I was there with my son, of course, you know, and I just told my son, I'm going to have you birthday gift. And he loved it. And he has read the book probably twice or three times. And I know you have actually traveled around to really share a story from the book, even in Ethiopia.
Yeah.
Even in Ethiopia.
Yeah, I had a great time in Ethiopia. Yeah. I mean, I love to perform in Ethiopia. I really do. Whether it was at Bahia Dar University or whether it was at the National Theatre, the British Council, the African Jazz Village, you know, many, many other places. And I feel really blessed, really, really blessed to have been accepted by the community that I found, you know. It's one of the great success stories of my life.
You know, I was kind of following on social media what was happening in Ethiopia. And one of our good friend, Elmias Kebede,
yes,
who is now in Ethiopia, was there. And he was tweeting about it, and he loved it. Was there any emotional moment for you?
Oh my gosh, there's so many. I mean, one time I was at the Ethiopian National Theatre in Addis, and I was reading with Boketu Seyum, and also another poet, Ephrem Seyum. And they're very different poets, but all three of us read on stage. And we were introduced by the world famous Ethiopian actress. She's based in Washington, DC, but also in Ethiopia. And I was reading on stage and somebody shouted out from the audience, "Welcome home, Lem, welcome home." And it was just the most beautiful thing. I'll never, ever forget that. And then I did a BBC recording live event at the African Jazz Village at the brilliant musicians venue. All of these events were packed, okay, like sold out. And I read a poem called Invisible Kisses. I still have the recording, it's online actually. And you could hear somebody weeping in the audience to the poem. Oh man, that was so, so, so powerful. The time at the British Council when Ato Afrowork Tekle came to see me read on stage. And he walked from the back and sat on the front row with the ex-mayor of Addis. And he was the mayor a long time ago. And Afrowork Tekle asked me a question. Like he made a statement. He didn't ask me a question. He said, he said, "You haven't picked up your keys yet." I'll never forget it. He said, "You know, I can see what you're doing." He said, "But you need to pick up your keys." He said, "I have picked up my keys, like the key." He said, "You haven't picked it up yet." It was such a powerful moment. And then the day after, he took me for a meal to, I think, Blue, the restaurant, the Blue Nile, is it, in Addis? And then a week later, he passed away. And he asked me to come to his studio, to his place, you know, his famous place. And I didn't take him up on it. Yeah, I wish I had. So there are so many, there are so many wonderful memories. You know, I have a sister who lives in Addis, and we were able to, she was also on a BBC recording I did, and that meant a lot to me as well. Most of my family are living different parts of the world, but I have a sister in Addis. Yeah, I mean, it's just an incredible place.
It is. You're right. Addis is so incredible. You know, I was born and raised in Addis, the center of Addis, and my heart is always in Addis, to be honest. Yeah. You know, yeah. So coming back to your book, because this wonderful book, My Name Is Why. Yes. You had the launch in that lovely book of yours. You know, you had the launch in Addis.
Yeah,
and I'm really keen if you have got any plans to take the book around Ethiopia. Ethiopia is a very big country, as you know. It's massive. You know, places like Awassa, Diredawa, Bahirdar. You know, elsewhere, to be honest. And another thing is there any plan to have it in Amharic?
I mean, I would love my book to be translated into Amharic, but I think it's important for especially Ethiopians to know that my book has not been translated into any language. So normally a book that's been successful, as my book has, it would be translated into Italian and German and French and Polish and, you know, Amharic. But because of the nature of the book, because of the files where it's written in English, it's very difficult to be able to have that effect that the files have. Does that make sense? You know,
yes, it does.
Look at this. Basically, I was stolen from my mother when I was a child, and I've proved that, and I was stolen from Ethiopia. But look at this picture, this young boy. That's the first time I saw this picture when I was writing this book. And look how Ethiopian he is, right? It's just, you know, it seems obvious to you now, but I did not meet an Ethiopian until I was like 9, and then I didn't know, and then much later on in life. So it's quite incredible. I wish my poetry was translated into Amharic, and I do know that I was in discussions with Ephrem Seyoum, who I heard had done some brilliant translations, but it's just that I could not get a publishing deal. You know, we couldn't get a publisher to publish it. I couldn't get a publisher to publish it. So, I wish I could have made that happen, but I just couldn't. And unfortunately, my friend Ephrem he felt quite offended by that, which is fair enough. I understand. But his translations I've heard are brilliant. So we'll see, maybe in the future. I'll tell you though, there are just so many brilliant Ethiopian poets in Ethiopia. And my favorite is Boketu Seyoum. And, you know, poets like him are the poets who I need to learn from.
Yeah, he is, yes, undoubtedly one of the best. You know, I met with him in London when he came to London. I don't know when, probably about 6-7 years ago.
I think it was 2012.
Okay. Yes, yeah. It's quite a while ago then. Yeah, so, and we had some good time together. And I really enjoyed his poems, but I do read them, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, the openness of, you know, his style, I really love it.
Yeah, he's a contemporary, modern poet. And what's really beautiful about him, and he's young, is that people read him all over Ethiopia, you know, and so, and he is open and he has like a radical vulnerability. He speaks his mind, even if it's not popular, you know. And he's also an accomplished poet, you know, he's an accomplished poet, and he is somebody who I look up to.
Thank you, Levin. Yes, I like him, and I really like him. I wish I would see him when I actually go to Ethiopia next, because he kind of makes me laugh and take my at ease, you know, because he's always at ease.
He's a star.
He is a great star. You're right. Lemon, you know, you have won many
just
awards.
One thing about Buketu, like, how do we get, like, Buketu to be famous here in London and in New York? Because, you know, the West Africans, they had Chinua Achebe, and then, and you can go from Chinua Achebe in the 1960s, you can go to Ngugi in Kenya, translated into English from Gikuyu, to Chimamanda Ngozi, okay, the, you know, very famous Nigerian writer of today, through to Wole Soyinka, etc. How do we get it so that we can get Ethiopian writers known outside of Ethiopia and across the world? We recently, there was a book of Ethiopian poetry that was published here in England. We have Marza Mengista, who was a Booker Prize writer. We have Ida Edna Mariam here in England, who wrote a book called The Wife's Tale, which is, I hear it's very Ethiopian.
Like, it is.
I hear people beautiful. Say, yeah, it's it so well-researched and well, because that's the story that she knows.
Yeah.
It's incredible. Like, so those writers live here, but how do we find writers who write in Amharic and translate their work into English and then get it known here, you know? That would be special.
You're right. That's going to be special. It's an assignment, especially for those of us who live in this part of the world.
Yeah,
can we help them, come to light? Because when I knew Buketu was coming, I just said, wow. And I had to go to this wonderful place, South Bank Center, where he presented his poems. And then we had an exciting time together. Yeah. But I know his writings, many people, if his writings were translated into English, many people would love it, because they just entertain you.
Yeah.
They are very honest.
Yeah.
Honest about, so, you know, there's a lot for us, people like myself and others who are around the world to do, because they really write. They honestly write, these guys. And they should also get, awards and prizes for that matter. You know, there's something we have to do. You know, how we should be in a position to nominate them and defend them. Because sometimes, you know, the culture, the tradition, everything really has impact on us. We don't actually go forward and say, this person should actually get this thing. We have to do all those things.
Yeah.
So, Lemon, it's a challenge for me and others.
And me too, you know, and it's a long life, you know. I'm in my early 50s now. So, you know, depending on how much more time I have in life, I'm sure I can do more.
Yeah.
I think I've done, you know, I've done my little bits here and there. Whether it's for Buketu or for Maaza Mengista, when I was on the Booker Prize judging panel, she became a shortlisted novelist, which was a big deal. And there's much more, but
Thanks, Lemon. I'll come back to Befkadu, you know, shortly. You have won many prizes and awards. You know, you have traveled, you're well traveled around the world.
Yeah.
But I remember, you know, a couple of interesting moments. One was the 16th of April, 2019. You know, we organized an event at the Ethiopian Embassy. And I was one of the co-organizers as co-founders of the Ethiopian Institute for Leadership, Communication and Organization called ELCO. And I was making a speech and I was talking about Ethiopia. Go to Ethiopia, go and see that wonderful country of ours. I'm excited. I was saying those wonderful things, but your facial expression kind of changed, you know. And I said, oh, my speech is making Lemon, you know, excited. Wanted to do something. So we founded ELCO, and then, so we're just looking for opportunities to kind of actually take back to Ethiopia. And when we knew this event was going to happen, we just stepped in and said, let's do it. As British citizens of Ethiopian origin, there's a lot we can contribute. So we thought this was a time. And luckily, we have got good relationship with IOHR, which has been really so helpful since its inception, for that matter. So we said, what can we do? And to just make it easy and short, we are going to have a panel on May the 1st, but we have also organized lectures at our university's School of Journalism on the 30s, and a lot to happen in Ethiopia. I'm so happy that we are all going to Ethiopia. There are about 10 of us going to Ethiopia in about two weeks' time. And for me to go back to Ethiopia again, because I was not in Ethiopia for about 13, 14 years, so it is a big deal for me as well. And it's a big deal for many of us. But something else happened at the same time. You got a text. Can you share that story?
Yeah, I was at that beautiful event at the Ethiopian Embassy for World Press Freedom Day, right? To precede World Press Freedom Day, which was being held in Addis in that year, 2019, right? And so I'm in the embassy and I'm listening to you speak. I'm saying hello to a few people. And I received a text while I was there to say that I had won the Pen Pinter Award. Okay, the 2019 Pen Pinter Award, and it was there. I was reading the text and thinking, because it's such an honor to get this award. I was so excited. But what was also quite strange is that event was about world press freedom, and the Pinter Award is all about freedom of artists. It's the Pen Pinter Award, right? Which is incredible, because I did, you know, and apparently there were people from Pen at the Ethiopian Embassy. Coincidences like this have happened throughout my life. I mean, my name means why, and I'm a poet. You know, I did not know what my name meant when I became a poet. I only learned when I was about 27, 28, what my name meant. I mean, incredible. And I think you caught it on film, which is even more incredible.
Yes, yes, we do have it. And I still have it. And we'll find it sometime soon in our video. So you won that award. And what happened is, you know, you had the opportunity to nominate somebody. You could have nominated anybody from around the world, but you chose to nominate, you know, the young, energetic Befkadu Hailu.
Yeah.
How did you reach that decision? Why him?
So I'd heard about the nine bloggers that were, the Zone 9 bloggers, okay, that were imprisoned. And I'd also heard about Dr. Abiy Ahmed releasing journalists from jail, you know, all the journalists at the time. And I, you know, spoke to various people about Befkadu I said, okay, who, which of the Zone 9 bloggers should I be looking at? This is before Pinter. And Befikadu was the one that everybody told me about. So I then researched him and looked at his Twitter feed. Look, what I'm looking for in a Penn Pinter International Award is a writer who risks their own liberty to tell their own truth. Okay, and that's a big deal, you know. And I think there are various writers. It could have been Buketu. It could have been Buketu, because I would say that he risks his own personal safety to be able to tell his truth. But because of Buketu had sacrificed his own life, his own freedom to tell the truth as he saw it, I wanted to support that noble quest to share information for all. And you know, Ethiopia has so many young, inspiring minds that choosing one is nearly impossible. But Befikadu is so well known that it would, winning the Pinter Prize would show his peer group, etc., that work that they do has an effect across the world, you know.
Thank you, Lemon. You know, you're right. You know, Zone 9ers were my favorites. They risked their lives. I know the challenge they went through. And Befikadu was one of my best. In fact, I met with him in 2019 when I was in Addis. He was actually one of the panelists at the event we organized at UNDCA. Him and Wubsha Taye were there. So when he sent him, yes, so he was in my panel, which was really well attended at the UNECA as part of the World Press Freedom Moments.
Yeah.
And when he texted me saying he was going to come for this award and the news, and I said, wow, you know. And then we actually had that excellent moment together at the British Library, you know, where we really enjoyed your speech. I remember the ambassador of Ethiopia was there, and yes, you know, we really loved it.
Well, isn't that amazing? Like, the coincidence is, not only did you catch me filming when I got the Pinter Prize, but you had no idea then who I was going to choose as the International Penn Pinter Prize. And it turns out to be Befikadu, who you were then going to see, who you must have already booked in Ethiopia when you filmed it, the event in London. Incredible. Incredible.
You know, this is life. There's always coincidence, you know, what do you call it? Interesting coincidence. Because I spoke to Befikadu probably a month or two before we organized an event at the Ethiopian Embassy. Because I loved the way, you know, his courage, you know, his courage, the risk. He still writes, he still takes risk. But I loved all the Zone 9ers. So I organized, as I was working on the panelists for the event in Addis, I spoke to him and he said, yes, you would be there. And we spent time together in Addis.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, you know, it's surprising. He told me he was coming and we just welcomed him. And then there was that interesting moment. And I loved the fact that he spoke in Amharic as well.
Yes.
You know, it was great.
Really, you know, I have to learn Amharic. I once, with a group of other artists, I met the Prime Minister, and I went to his offices with many other artists, and I couldn't understand. So somebody helped me by translating for me, but I remember thinking, how can I sit with the Prime Minister of Ethiopia and hear him speak and not understand because I don't speak the language. And yes, I was stolen from Ethiopia. I had the language stolen from me. I didn't know I was Ethiopian until I was much later in life. And I must learn to speak Amharic.
Thank you, Lemon. Yes, you will have to learn because many people would want to speak to you in Amharic. So I think we are going to organize a session for you at some point. I'm going to take you to, this a number of honorary doctorate degrees, you have had from about 4 universities, but you are also Chancellor of University of Manchester. What does it mean to be a Chancellor for that matter?
Well, the Chancellor of the University of Manchester is a ceremonial role, which is you're the head of the university, but your job is to confer degrees and maybe make connections for the university in various places as it sees fit. So the real person who does the main work of the university is Vice Chancellor Nancy Rothwell. But the beauty of being a chancellor is that you can talk about the university and make connections with other universities around the world. Of course, it's been very challenging this past year. Our university is very big. It's a Russell Group university in England. It's a highly respected university and some of the greatest professors there. But the last year has been a challenge which we've risen to, with blended learning, etc. It's a place I'm proud to be Chancellor of. We run the Equity and Merit Scholarship Scheme, which links with Ethiopia, and that's something that I brokered and that was launched at the British Embassy in Ethiopia. And so now we have students applying, I think at the moment, actually, every year to come over to Manchester, and then we go back to Ethiopia with them to do a PhD. So,
yeah, I love universities. We have got some of the best universities in this country, United Kingdom.
Yeah.
I would really be happy if there's any possibility of twinning some of the universities here, because you have got all these degrees from a number of universities, so connecting some of these universities with some of ours should be among the staff. I studied at Addis Ababa University, my first degree.
And you studied under Andreas? Professor Elias?
No.
Oh, okay.
Before him, because I graduated in 1992.
Okay, yeah.
So, but that was an amazing university, and my heart is always there. And for your information, when we organized an event in 2019 as part of the World of Press Freedom Day, I organized a session at School of Journalism, and Befekadu, and Wilbur Shirt and many people which we took from this country spoke there and shared their experiences.
With Manchester?
Addis.
Oh. Okay, yeah.
Addis Ababa
University. Yeah, it's a good thing.
So I'm really keen, if there's anything we can do to twin some of the universities with some of ours.
Be great for Manchester to twin with Addis Ababa University. Wouldn't that be wonderful?
It would be.
And I know there's been a massive expansion of universities in Ethiopia as well. Well, I will. I've got a year left as Chancellor, just 1 year. So hopefully this COVID will lift and I can get back to maybe suggesting to the university that we do twin with you.
Yeah, so we have to come back to this because I would be really keen. So let's take it as a homework for us.
Let's do that.
Yes, I want to see, you know, our universities being twinned, sharing experiences, and, you know, our youngsters getting opportunities, especially women.
Yeah.
I really want to see as many women as possible, you know, getting these opportunities and possibly in positions of power.
So, yeah, I mean, there are a few universities which I have doctorates at, which may be interested in twinning, actually. You know, because it's about making an open call, because there are so many different research departments in universities that they would be, yeah, that's a really good idea.
Yes, and then, you know, all those connections, let's use them.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if not now, then when?
I know, yeah. I did meet the head of the university at Addis Ababa University, and
Yeah, so we have a follow-up to this conversation.
Yeah.
And do something, you know, so that we just say, yes, I did it. I contributed something. You know, when there was a change in Ethiopia, I thought probably organizing a bit of leadership training for some of our senior folks would help. And I did reach out to Harvard University. I studied at Harvard, you know, on the leadership, a course called Global Change.
Right.
And I had some connections there.
Yeah.
And as soon as I saw the change, you know, I just thought there was a need to, you know, organize a session called Adaptive Leadership, which was really important for us. And they were really willing to do it. But, you know, I didn't take it forward, but that's one of the things I would be doing as well.
Right, let's talk. Yeah.
Yes, we have to do it. Yeah. So, Lemon, you know, you love Ethiopia. Your love for that country is massive.
I miss it, man. It's like been over a year just before lockdown in January 2020, I went to Addis, and then I came back. I did some filming, which was then shown in May 2020 in England, a documentary called The Memory of Me. Took a film crew there, and then I haven't been since, and it's driving me crazy. It's been the longest time I've been away from Ethiopia. I need to come over to live for a year or so. That would be my dream, would be to spend a year living in Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm. I do have a plan as well, because, you know, there's I strongly believe that there's something we should be contributing, and I strongly believe again that this is a time. Because if you don't do it today, then, you know, you don't know about tomorrow. Tomorrow is only a promise, whereas today is for granted. Yeah, so as someone connected to Ethiopia, well-traveled, what's your advice for those who are contemplating to see Ethiopia? You know, for those who might be interested in investing in Ethiopia, and probably, you know, those who might really want to see a bit of what you call evidence about Ethiopia, what would you say to them?
Oh my gosh. I would say look at the people. That's the first thing, you know. Just start to understand the people of Ethiopia, and then you'll start to understand the richness of Ethiopia. That's the first thing. I would say, look at the past and look at the richness and the uniqueness of Ethiopia, and look at the resources that Ethiopia has to offer the world, and take a good look at Ethiopian Airlines, and That's not really a great answer. Well, I would simply say it's the best place in the world.
Thank you, Levin. You know, any message to Ethiopians in Amharic? Probably three or four.
Oh, Ethiopians in Amharic. Is she? All I know is diaspora Amharic. So all I would say is, where is my book, The Amharic for Foreigners? It's somewhere. I would say, Amasaganalo. I will learn more. I try to explain to people, I spent all my life searching for my family. I found them, you know, and then I have to learn a language as well, and I've kind of resisted it, but I know that to truly understand Ethiopia, you really have to learn the language, a language. There are many languages in Ethiopia. Learn one of them. You know.
So it's down to me and others to encourage you to learn Amharic. That's the only language I know. But you're right, Ethiopia is blessed. It's got, you know, lots of languages, lots of religion, lots of cultures, beautiful people. It's so amazing. And, you know, I can't wait until I see you in Addis as well, because Addis would be the next destination for us.
Yeah, I look forward to it. Thank you, Bukele.
Levin Sisay, it's been a pleasure talking to you for the Ethiopian Digest in Conversation with program. This conversation will be on our social media accounts, including YouTube. Once again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.